the Anabaptists and other groups originated in the Protestant Reformation of the 16th century. Martin Luther, a Roman Catholic priest, initiated a series of events in 1517 which shook, divided, and in some instances revitalized Christianity in Western Europe. These events are collectively known as the Reformation. Ulrich Zwingli, a Swiss priest, instituted a similar series of reforms in the city of Zurich in 1520 to 1523, which attracted several young men, including Conrad Grebel, Felix Mons, George Blaurock, and Wilhelm Rublin. These men and others, who at first were ardent followers of Zwingli, parted company with him as early as 1523 on various issues, including state-church separation and baptism as a symbolic experience. The rift was quickly widening, so that by 1525, Anabaptism under the leadership of Conrad Grebel was a reality. Zwingli, in the Zurich City Council, reacted against the so-called Anabaptists with a program of intense persecution. The persecution in Zurich and other parts of Switzerland drove many Anabaptists to the neighboring northern and eastern areas, Alsace, the Palatinate, Moravia, and the Netherlands. In the Netherlands, a Catholic priest, Menno Simons, after some deep inner turmoil, joined the Anabaptist movement in 1536. In time, he became the leader of the Dutch Anabaptists. His followers were soon referred to as Mennonites and finally as Mennonites. In the early 1600s, Central Europe was ravaged by war. The Thirty Years' War was fought from 1618 to 1648. It was initially a religious war fought between Protestant and Catholic states in the fragmented Holy Roman Empire. It gradually developed into a more general conflict involving most of the great powers. By the end, 8 million lives had been lost due to violence, famine, and plagues. Entire regions were devastated, with the warring mercenary armies looting and extorting tribute to get operating funds. Anabaptists took no sides in this war, although they suffered great losses as well. The Anabaptists, who were banished from Zurich and had migrated to Moravia, a group known as the Hutterites, were robbed of their land and possessions and deported from the country. At great suffering and hardship, they sought refuge in Hungary and Transylvania. After the war came to a close in 1648, the governments sought to rebuild the devastated countrysides and were glad to have people with high moral standards who would work diligently. Traditionally, because of religious persecution, as well as the concept of separation from the world, Anabaptists tend to gather and live in remote rural areas and became specialized in successfully farming marginal land. Thus, in some areas, the Anabaptists were willingly granted refuge and limited religious liberty as they took part in rebuilding the war-torn countryside. The most significant Anabaptist religious development in the period from 1560 to 1786 was the Amish Schism of 1695, which split the Mennonite churches in Switzerland, the Palatinate, and Alsace. The controversy, referred to historically as the Amon-Riest controversy, was over separation from evil, nonconformity, and other minor issues. It reached its climax when Jacob Amon, a Mennonite elder in Switzerland and Alsace, insisted that all Mennonite ministers accept the newly introduced practice of shunning, which means social and religious avoidance of excommunicated members. Amon also sought uniformity in dress, including style of hats, cut of clothing, pattern of shoes and stockings, and wearing of the untrimmed beard. The opposition, led by Elder Hans Riest, refused to acquiesce, and a split resulted. Most of the churches in the Palatinate, and virtually all the churches in Switzerland, followed Riest, who led the larger of the two groups, while a few from these areas and virtually all the churches in the Alsace followed Ammon. The Riest-Ammon controversy has long been forgotten in Europe, but over 200,000 Amish live in North America today. They, like their spiritual leader, tend to be stricter than most Mennonites. The Ammon-Riest controversy is important to our history because the early families who came to settle the Iowa prairies around Wayland were largely Amish. In the late 1700s and early 1800s, increasing religious persecution and increasing nationalism led many Mennonite and Amish groups to resettle to America. The first settlements were in the province of Pennsylvania, founded by the Quaker William Penn, who was an early advocate of democracy and religious freedom. From Pennsylvania, the Mennonite and Amish migrated west, particularly to Ohio and Indiana, but also to Iowa, Missouri, and Illinois. Quite often, migrating groups first came to Pennsylvania or Ohio, worked for a period of time to establish themselves financially, and then moved further westward to settle their own lands. In 1846, Joseph Goldsmith came to Lee County, Iowa, by way of Ontario, Canada, and Butler County, Ohio. He was an Amish bishop and formed a church amongst the pioneer families living in Lee County. This congregation met in their various homes until 1850, when a church building was constructed in a timber about a mile and a half east of Franklin, Iowa. Because it was located in the timber, it became known as the Bush Church. John C. Crable was the pastor of this group. John was the first Amishman to settle in Iowa, and his child, Joanna Maria, was the first Amish child born in Iowa. Joseph Goldsmith would spend his adult life establishing churches in southeast Iowa. Congregations that were formed under his leadership include Zion in Donelson, Pulaski in Davis County, the Bush Church in Franklin, West Point Mennonite, Sugar Creek and Eicher churches in the Wayland area, and Deer Creek and Sharon churches in the Kelowna area. Two of these early Goldsmith churches would be instrumental in the formation of the General Conference of Mennonite Churches. In 1858, Daniel Crable of the West Point congregation observed that isolated and scattered Mennonite groups sometimes had little in common. At his suggestion, the West Point congregation and the Zion congregation met in 1859 in West Point. Two ministers from Pennsylvania attended the meeting, and one from Polk County, Iowa. A second conference meeting was held in Wadsworth, Ohio in 1860. One of the first efforts of this new general conference was the process of promoting, raising funds, and building the Wadsworth Institute, a three-year Mennonite seminary in Wadsworth, Ohio, that would train men for the mission field. This new conference work showed that times were changing for Mennonites in America. Never before had they worked together on a project of this size. Churches, with their unpaid ministers, had little practice in raising funds. But more and more people caught the vision of workers going overseas and preaching for Christ, and this was a significant unifying effort. The first church service for the Henry, Washington County Amish Mennonites was conducted in the home of Daniel Conrad by Bishop Joseph Goldsmith of Lee County, perhaps between the years 1849 and 1852. After this time, the church was visited frequently by Goldsmith, and a few years later, in 1855, he moved into the community and took complete charge of the congregation. It was customary to alternate services between the two areas of population, one Sunday in the district south of Wayland, and the next Sunday in the northern area near Noble. Goldsmith was assisted by ministers Christian Beckler, Joseph Wittrig, and John von Gunden. Soon after 1860, the two districts separated into separate congregations, with Goldsmith in charge of both. In 1862, Benjamin Eicher was ordained as minister of the Northern Congregation. In 1866, Eicher was ordained as bishop of the Northern Group, and the congregation continued to meet in members' homes and barns. This barn, owned by Joseph and Elizabeth Summer, was used regularly for services. Benjamin Eicher was born in Alsace, France, in 1832. At the age of 17, he left France and settled in Wayne County, Ohio. In 1853, after 4 years in Ohio, he came to Washington County, Iowa, and by 1854, had purchased 40 acres of improved land in the Noble area. He taught school for 15 years and would eventually own 200 acres of land and operate a dairy producing 100,000 pounds of butter annually. He also owned and operated a thrashing rig. Biographers of Benjamin Eicher characterize him as a man of striking personality whose mind was keen and penetrating. He was a student all his life and kept pace with the progress of scientific and religious thought. Benjamin Eicher married Lydia Summer in 1855, and in time, 13 children would bless this marriage. In 1868, the congregation, under the leadership of Eicher, built the first church building in the area, which was a novel idea at the time. It was a 30 by 40 framed structure with two entrances on the south, one for men and one for women. It had three anterooms, one for men, one for women, and one used for mothers and babies. It was heated with two wood-burning stoves and is reported to have cost $600 to construct. This building served the group well until 1895, when a growing congregation constructed a larger building at the same location. The original building was moved about 1 mile north and converted into a greenery, and was used for that purpose for many more years. Under Eicher's leadership, starting in 1862, the congregation became progressively more liberal. They were part of a growing movement in the Amish Mennonite Church, and a series of ministers' meetings were held throughout the country to try to resolve differences. The movement away from Amish beliefs and traditions was slow and gradual, but the local break may have taken place at a meeting in May of 1874 in John Conrad's barn, located about 2.5 miles northeast of Noble. This meeting was attended by about 1,000 people from Pennsylvania, Ohio, Indiana, Illinois, and Iowa, and upwards of 20 ministers preached 5 or 6 sermons throughout the day. A major focus of the discussion that day was reported to be the use of hook and eyes on men's vests versus buttons. Eicher attended the meeting wearing buttons, and it was expected that he and the members of the church who wouldn't conform to the general rule would be expelled. The church was not expelled. It simply withdrew and ceased to cooperate with the more conservative groups. The Eicher Church continued an independent course until 1893, when, still under the leadership of Ben Eicher, it joined the General Conference of Mennonite Churches. This conference meeting, held in Bluffton, Ohio, proved to be one of Eicher's last church tasks. He took ill just days after returning home and died of an apparent heart attack on December 7th, 1893. That he was a well-respected member of the local community was apparent in that 168 teams of horses and drivers participated in the processional. Benjamin's son William served as minister of the church for 1 year following his father's death. In 1894, Eicher Church called H.G. Ollibaugh to the pastorate. Harvey Ollibaugh was born in Montgomery County, Pennsylvania, in 1869. His mother died when he was 2, and he lived his younger years with his maternal grandparents. He accepted the call to Eicher Church at age 25. During his tenure, he helped to organize a Young People's Society of Christian Endeavor. This multi-denominational group involved youth in Christian life and service. By 1906, 67,000 youth-led societies had been organized worldwide, with over 4 million members. Christian Endeavor took up many causes and was influential in supporting the temperance movement of the 1920s. Historically, the Christian Endeavor movement is considered to be the forerunner of and the model for modern-day youth ministry. Harvey Albaugh also helped to organize a women's missionary society at Eicher. Women's Missionary Society originated at the Zion Mennonite Church in Donelson, Iowa. The society provided a way for women to learn, to share, and to provide for the material needs of others. One of the projects for the Donelson women was to provide linens for the Wadsworth Institute. The Eicher ladies had similar projects. In 1895, the first church building was replaced with the second building, which was slightly larger than the original, measuring approximately 30 feet by 50 feet. It was constructed adjacent to the original structure. The new building was dedicated in March 1896. On dedication day, the congregation met in the old building for a short service and then moved over to the new building where two additional services were held. Two more services were also held on Monday. In 1897, Harvey Albaugh married Benjamin Eicher's daughter, Clara. They soon left Eicher Church to take charge of the Darlington Mennonite Mission, which was located in central Oklahoma among the Cheyenne and Arapaho Indian settlements. This mission was started by the General Conference in 1880 and was one of the first projects for the young organization. As a historical side note, Harvey Albaugh's half-sister was Anne Albaugh, who has the distinction of being the first Mennonite woman to be ordained in North America. She was active in the Christian Endeavor Society of her church as a youth, forming the first group in her area. She trained at New York University, Columbia University, and Union Theological Seminary in New York City. She was ordained in 1911 by Minister N.B. Grubb, perhaps without much conference support. She was a guest speaker at Eastern churches during the years from 1911 to 1916, and then in 1916 accepted a call from the Sunnyside Reformed Church in Long Island. She passed away from an apparent heart attack in 1918 at the age of 43. In 1897, Peter Stuckey accepted the call from the congregation to replace Harvey Albaugh. The church, under Albaugh's direction, had been conducting Sunday school services and preaching on alternate Sunday afternoons in the school building in town. With a growing number of members living near or in the town of Wayland, this continued under the direction of Peter Stuckey, and by 1900, a separate church building had been constructed, with Stuckey in charge of both congregations. The Eicher and Wayland Mennonite churches shared pastors until 1927, when Wayland Mennonite became a separate congregation. Peter Stuckey was an older man and retired from the active ministry in 1903, moving back to the Bluffton, Ohio area for his retirement years. S.M. Samuel Musselman served the Eicher congregation from 1903 to 1920. The congregation was growing and many changes were happening. The congregation now numbered about 200, up 50 members from 10 years prior. In 1908, additional land was added to the cemetery. In 1911, the third and current church building was constructed and membership had grown to 240. The new church had seating for 300. In 1917, a kitchen was added to the church basement, and in 1918, the church was wired for electricity. Lights were used for the first time for the Christmas service on December 22, 1918. By 1917, church services, which had been conducted in German, were now English language only, with only an occasional hymn sung in German. There remained one Sunday school class for men and one Sunday school class for women in German, which ended in the 1930s. In 1920, Samuel Musselman resigned his position at Eicher Church to become a professor at the newly organized Whit-Marsum Theological Seminary, which was associated with Bluffton College. In 1920, Lewis Miller was called to the pastorate at Eicher Church. Pastor Miller organized the first community Bible school and the first get-together meeting of the four General Conference churches in Iowa. The first get-together was held in May of 1921 in Donelson, and 65 Eicher members attended. Pastor and Mrs. Miller directed a youth pageant for this gathering, which was well received. They moved away from the area in 1922. In the summer of 1922, services were led by A.S. Arthur Rosenberger. Rosenberger had previously attended Penn State University, studying agriculture. Hearing God's call in his life, he transferred to Bluffton College and was graduated in 1921. 2 years later, he earned his divinity degree from Whit-Marsum. It was during his time at Whit-Marsum that he was a summer intern at Eicher Church. Following his pastorate in Iowa, he pastored churches in Ohio and Pennsylvania. By 1935, he had assumed the presidency of Bluffton College. Rosenberger was extensively involved in education and served on numerous church boards throughout his lifetime. For the years 1922 to 1924, Eicher Church was under the leadership of Pastor Peter Rieger. He published a monthly newsletter called The Church Visitor, which, in his words, helped bind together the bond of Christian fellowship between members of the congregation just a little bit closer. The publication contained articles about church activities, as well as members' news of interest and happenings of note. Henry J. Schrag followed Peter Rieger as pastor of the Eicher congregation. He assumed his duties in the fall of 1924 and served until 1930. In the early 1920s, the congregation had a membership of 282 members. And by the late 1920s, membership would peak at 313. In 1925, Pastor Schrag conducted the first baby consecration service held at Eicher Church, during which four babies were dedicated. In 1926, the first vacation Bible school was held at Eicher Church. 81 students and 5 teachers were involved in this effort. In 1927, the Eicher and Wayland churches voted to separate the congregations, and Henry Schrag remained as the pastor of the Eicher congregation. In 1929, the present parsonage was built. Construction started in May of that year and continued into the fall. In addition to the parsonage, a garage, chicken house, cistern, and board well were completed. Pastor and Mrs. Schrag moved into the residence on October 15, 1929. A dedication ceremony took place on Sunday, October 27, 1929, just 2 days prior to the famous Black Tuesday stock market crash of October 29th. Alan H. Miller served the Eicher congregation as pastor from 1930 to 1936. He has the dubious distinction of being one of only two Eicher pastors to date, of which no photograph is known to exist. Artifacts that do survive from this period include a program of the 43rd session of the Middle District Conference that was held at Eicher Church in August of 1931, and a printed itinerary for a week-long series of Bible lectures held at the church, also in 1931. The theme for the five-day conference meeting was Looking to Jesus, to which a different pastor spoke each day. The Women's Missionary Society heard reports from India, Africa, and China, and business reports were delivered concerning Bluffton College and Whit-Marsum Seminary. The Saturday afternoon service was conducted by Reverend Delbert Welty of the Zion Congregation in Donelson, who would assume leadership of the Eicher congregation after Pastor Miller, starting in 1936. The seven-day series of Bible lectures, presented by J.E. Hartzler, a former president of the Whit-Marsum Theological Seminary at Bluffton, included a lecture on the Oberammergau Passion Play, complete with 50 color pictures, which has been presented every decade since 1634, with only two exceptions. As mentioned earlier, Delbert Welty, previously in charge of the Zion congregation in Donelson, served at Eicher Church from 1936 to 1943. The Great American Depression was ongoing, and no doubt finances were tight during these years. A glimpse at the 1941 yearbook reports that the church had beginning balances of $127. Receipts for the year totaled $1,513. Pastor Welty was paid an annual salary of $1,000, and general church expenditures totaled $632. The balance on hand at the end of the year was just under $9. The statistical report shows membership that year of 258 persons, and some simple math shows that the average giving per member was $6.33. In spite of the financial burdens of the times, the church continued its mission work. The Mission Treasurer's Report for the same year lists financial gifts being sent to the China Mission, the India Mission, the Oklahoma Mission at Darlington, and other gifts listed as foreign and home missions. A photo album created by the Eicher Ladies Mission Society has pictures from the Hope Villa, Arizona Mission with the Hopi Tribe. The Ladies Mission Society reports $135 in expenses that year, with $10 being sent to the Arizona Church. World War II was the largest armed conflict in human history. Although the war began with Germany's attack on Poland in 1939, the United States did not enter the war until the Japanese bombing of Pearl Harbor in 1941. The American government, in preparation for the war that was looming on the horizon, initiated the Selective Service Act, the draft, in 1940. This was the first peacetime draft in United States history. By the end of the war in 1945, 50 million men between ages 18 and 45 had registered for the draft, and 10 million had been inducted into the military. Locally, men who were drafted from the Eicher congregation were split roughly 50-50 between those who served in the military versus those who served in CPS, or civilian public service. The American government recognized the need for CO, or conscientious objector status, following World War I, when CO draftees were required to report to military camps and plead to officials on a case-by-case basis, sometimes being interred in military camps or in rare instances in prison until the end of the war. Approximately 12,000 men, or 1.2% of the 10 million drafted, served in 152 camps throughout the United States and Puerto Rico. Draftees worked in areas such as soil conservation, forestry, firefighting, and agriculture, as well as social and mental health services. Mennonite Central Committee administered many of the camps across the United States and two here in Iowa. The camp at Denison, Iowa was a soil and water conservation camp, and the camp at Mount Pleasant was headquartered at the Mental Health Institute and provided medical and social services to the patients there. The CPS men served with minimal support from the federal government. The cost of maintaining the CPS camps and providing for the needs of the men was the responsibility of their congregations and families. CPS men served longer than regular draftees and were not released until well after the end of the war. Initially skeptical of the program, government agencies learned to appreciate the men's service and requested more workers from the program. CPS made significant contributions to forest fire prevention, erosion and flood control, medical science, and reform of the mental health system. Pastor Welty resigned his position at Eicher Church in 1943 and accepted a pastorate at Altoona Mission Church in Altoona, Pennsylvania. He was followed by Pastor Leonard Metzger, who served the congregation from 1943 to 1945. It was during his tenure that 5 acres of land just north of the church was purchased for $500. An ambitious program of underbrush clearing, tree planting, trail and picnic ground development was undertaken by the congregation. At a later date, fruit trees were added, and at a later date still, the David Allen Graber Shelter House was constructed. Walter Rieger assumed leadership of the church following Pastor Metzger's tenure. He led the congregation from 1945 to 1949. Post-war recovery was a major focus of activities during this period. MCC had established a representative in Europe within 3 months of the beginning of the war, working to begin negotiations for a relief program in Poland. Representatives quickly moved into areas devastated by the fighting, and early efforts were centered around feeding children and old people who had been bombed out of their homes. As rapidly as possible, new efforts were opened in practically all countries in Western Europe. By the end of 1945, MCC had 14 workers in France, 9 in Holland, 3 in Belgium, and 2 at the MCC headquarters. By 1946, the work was extended to Germany, Denmark, and Austria. By 1947, the relief effort was in full swing. That year, 43 workers distributed 4,538 tons of food and clothing in Germany alone. By 1950, MCC and its affiliates had expended more than $12 million in cash and commodities for relief efforts, and several million dollars more for the resettlement of refugees. Locally, the Eicher congregation worked to send cash and commodities to MCC for distribution. A look at the 1946 yearbook lists cash disbursements to MCC of $210, as well as the following commodities: beef, 354 quarts; pork, 196 quarts; chicken, 144 quarts; tallow, 4 quarts; lard, 350 pounds; peaches, 139 quarts; corn, 208 quarts; tomatoes, 210 quarts; beans, 15 quarts. 775 pounds of clothing was also collected and sent. The same 1946 yearbook lists 5 local members serving in relief efforts. They were Dale Niebel, Erwin Graber, Glenn Graber, and Mr. and Mrs. Aaron Herr. Dale Neble was stationed in 7 different CPS camps and was camp director at Three Rivers, California, which was a National Park Service camp where the men fought fires, repaired roads and trails, and performed other preventive maintenance. After CPS, he was a director of MCC relief operations in China and the Philippines from 1946 to 1949. From 1953 to 54, he was the MCC director of relief in the Far East, which included Hong Kong, Taiwan, Japan, Java, and Korea. Erwin Graber served in 5 different CPS camps from 1942 to 1946. Glenn Graber served in 2 CPS camps and spent most of the rest of his life working in Taiwan in missionary efforts. Aaron and Mrs. Herr worked in China from 1946 to 1949, and then in 1950 was on staff at the newly formed Mennonite Mutual Aid offices. The first project of MMA was assisting in the rehabilitation of returning CPS men. During the years from 1949 to 1953, the Eicher congregation was under the care of Pastor Leander Fast. There is little documented of the happenings of the church during this time, but towards the end of the period, glimpses of unrest can be seen, especially in the pastor's report for the year 1952. Although the specifics of the separation are unknown, by summer of 1953, Pastor Fast had left along with approximately 50 Eicher members to form the Ferncliff Evangelical Free Church, which continues on as a successful church in the rural Wayland community. During the summer months of 1953, Milton Harder led the congregation as an interim pastor. He previously worked with MCC in Germany, and following his interim at Eicher, assumed leadership of the youth program of the General Conference. Pastor Harvey Neunemaker led the congregation from 1953 to 1961. It was under his leadership that a Mennonite Disaster Service, or MDS group, was formed in the congregation. Also, during his tenure, a Men's Brotherhood group was started. It was during the latter part of 1958 and 1959 that planning was started for a retirement home in the Wayland community. A Wayland newspaper clipping from March of 1959 reports that a vote was taken in the 4 participating Mennonite churches in the community, and with the majority of members in all the churches being in support, the Parkview Home Project moved forward. From its early beginnings, the home was a cooperative effort between the churches, their members, and the general community. Financing the project was accomplished through loans from participating churches and their members, as well as traditional loans from area banks. Bill Freienberger from the Eicher congregation was a member of the original finance committee. Groundbreaking ceremonies were held April 10th, 1960, with Pastor Neunemaker of the Eicher congregation delivering the keynote address. Construction of the home took approximately 1 year. A significant portion of the labor was donated by individuals in Sunday school classes, as well as other groups. An early report from the Home Association lists 5,700 hours of donated labor during the initial phase of construction. The home commenced operations on May 8, 1961. Erwin Graber was the first superintendent. Elon Bushart, chairman of the building committee, in his speech at the dedication service, said that the completion of the home was just the beginning of the church's and community's obligation to the home. The labor of love was just starting. Over the years, many additions as well as maintenance and modernization projects to the home have been accomplished, with many contributions coming from local churches and individuals. In 1960, Parkview Home, to the local Mennonite churches, can be compared to the Wadsworth Institute and the General Conference in 1860, a significant unifying effort. During the summer of 1961, Ernest Sawatsky led the congregation as an intern. He was studying at the Swift Current Bible Institute in Saskatchewan, and after his summer at Iker and an assistantship at an Elkhart church, he went on to mission work with the Cree Indians in Manitoba. Archie Penner led the congregation from 1961 to 1963. During the time he served the church, he was also completing a doctorate degree at the University of Iowa. During his lifetime, he authored 7 books. The theme of much of his work centered on the relationship of church and state. And in his 1959 book, The New Testament, The Christian and the State, he argues strongly that Anabaptists must separate themselves from government and avoid the electoral process. Archie Penner, a scholar of radical Anabaptism, lived almost to the age of 90 years and only retired from teaching at the age of 82. Pastor T.A. Vandersmissen was called to serve the Iker congregation in 1963. He preached his first service in June of that year, and by September had suffered a heart attack. His illness required convalescence until early 1964. He preached again for a time, but by December of 1964 had resigned his position. During Pastor Vandersmissen's illness, messages were brought by Pastor Archie Penner and Omer Nisley of Wayland, among others. Following Pastor Vandersmissen's resignation, Omer Nisley was called on an interim basis to lead the congregation, which he accepted for the year 1965. In 1965, Pastor Rudy Martins accepted the call to lead the Iker congregation. Previous to his pastorate here at Iker, he and his wife Elvina, a physician, had served a church in Michigan. Prior to Michigan, they were serving with MCC in the Belgium Congo from 1953 to 1960 as missionaries. In 1960, the Congo gained independence from Belgium, and a bloody civil war followed. The newly formed government was backed by Western powers, and the black nationalists were backed by the Soviet Union. As the deadly conflict continued, UN peacekeeping forces were sent into the country. MCC withdrew from the country at this time due to the dangerous turmoil. Both Western and Eastern powers had a stake in the outcome of this conflict, as the Congo was the source of much of the uranium used to manufacture nuclear weapons. By 1970, tensions eased enough in the Congo that the Martins resigned the pastorate at Iker Church and returned to the Congo to continue their work there. Pastor Nick Kassebaum replaced Rudy Martins in September of 1970. He taught classes at the University of Iowa as well as took classes as a student. In March of 1971, Iker and Wayland Mennonite entered into an agreement to share the services of Pastor Kassebaum. He served both churches until 1972, when he resigned at Iker to become the full-time pastor at Wayland Mennonite. From 1972 to 1976, the Iker congregation was served by 2 lay pastors. Harold Ricks served the congregation from 72 to 74, and George King served from 74 to 76. Dr. Paul Gosin served the Iker congregation from 1976 to 1990. He received his education at Grace University in Omaha and Grace Theological Seminary in Elkhart. He received his doctorate at Western Conservative Seminary in Portland, Oregon. He served churches in Nebraska, South Dakota, and Pennsylvania prior coming to Eicher Church. He loved to teach, and by 1978 had established the Southeast Iowa Training School. The school was designed to improve the skills of Sunday school teachers and other church leaders. Each class met weekly for one quarter, and those who completed the course received certificates. The training school operated for 9 years. In 1980, the first Iowa Mennonite Relief Sale was organized. The project is sponsored annually by over 20 Mennonite and other Anabaptist churches in Iowa. The relief sale is a means of raising funds to support the work of MCC, currently in its 96th year and operating in more than 60 countries around the world. The major focus of MCC is relief efforts, development, and peace initiatives. In North America, 44 relief sales are held in 21 U.S. states and 5 Canadian provinces. In 1989, Pastor Gosin initiated Adventure Club, a Wednesday evening Christian program for children. He is fondly remembered as the proprietor of the Noble Bee and was a longtime master beekeeper. Pastor Gosin left Eicher Church in 1990 to devote full-time efforts to a ministry with members of the Amana Society in the Amana colonies. In 1991, Melvin Cain was called to the pastorate at Eicher Church, and he served the congregation faithfully until 2003. Building friendships and fellowship within the community were important goals for Melvin and his wife, Delora. Pastor Cain continued the Adventure Club, started by Pastor Gosin, and this outreach continued to be very successful. In 1993, he initiated the Living in Faithful Evangelism, or LIFE, program at Eicher Church. The LIFE program was initiated in several area Mennonite churches, and its main focus was to help the congregation be more sensitive and welcoming to people who were not used to going to church. As an interesting side note, Dave and Kathy Schooley were coordinators for the LIFE program in this area and spoke here at Eicher to introduce the program. In 1993, Dr. Bob Pusey of the Eicher congregation volunteered for a short-term mission trip with other Southeast Iowa health professionals to work in the Baltic state of Latvia. While in country, the team provided health and dental care to persons in need. The goal of the trip was to provide health care services as well as build a bridge of friendship from Southeast Iowa to the Latvian citizens. In 2003, one focus of the Eicher congregation was the construction of a new wing of the church that included new public restrooms, a pastor's study, a fellowship hall, and kitchen. The new space has proven to be a valued gathering place for church programs, celebrations, as well as the occasional potluck. In 2003, the Canes resigned the pastorate at Eicher Church to attend to the needs of their family in South Dakota. Herb Yoder followed Pastor Cain, and he served the congregation from 2004 to 2008. Herb has pastored churches in Indiana, Michigan, Nebraska, and Iowa prior to coming to Eicher Church. Herb and the congregation mourned the death of his wife in February of 2004, and on Valentine's Day of 2006, celebrated his marriage to Dorothy Kaler. Under Herb's leadership, starting in 2007, the Eicher congregation became a satellite packaging center for Kids Against Hunger, now known as Takeaway Hunger. This program packages specially formulated, dehydrated meals that meet the special dietary requirements of the hungry. The ingredients are supplied and distributed around the world to areas of need by Don and Sandy Fields of Liberty Ministries, located in Mount Pleasant. To date, the Eicher congregation has assisted community groups, Sunday school classes, and individual families to package 405,330 meals. Herb Yoder retired in 2008 after 60 years in the ministry. Larry Evers was called to the Eicher Pastorate in 2008, and he served until 2013. From the very first, he challenged the congregation to thoughtfully consider the church's mission statement. Larry asked us, how would this group worship, care, call others, and be welcoming? In 2011, part of Larry's question to us was answered when, with his encouragement, Eicher joined with Wayland Mennonite, Sugar Creek Mennonite, First Mennonite in Iowa City, and Cedar Falls Mennonite to jointly form a supportive partnership with Torre Forte, a Hispanic congregation meeting at First Mennonite in Iowa City. That congregation was led by Max and Gloria Villatoro. The sponsoring churches provided monetary support and, perhaps more importantly, worshiped together and formed deep friendships. Early in 2015, Max was detained and deported to Honduras by U.S. immigration authorities. Gloria, with the help of others, continued the work of the Torre Forte Church. It is, true to its name, a strong tower. Sadly, at this point in time, Max remains separated from Gloria and the children. Larry Evers retired from the ministry in 2013. He and Elva have moved around the country exploring different regions they have always wanted to experience. Their first move was to Fairbanks, Alaska. Bob Hartzler served as interim pastor following Larry Evers' retirement. Bob has served the Mennonite Church and its congregations in many capacities over the years. This congregation was blessed and strengthened by his leadership during the transition of pastors. After his year with us as an interim, he continued to work with Dave Schooley as a mentor. Dave Schooley accepted the call to lead the Eicher congregation in 2014. A businessman earlier in life, Dave heard God calling him to the ministry, and after 2 years here with the Eicher congregation, was formally ordained into the ministry in September of 2016. Dave's friendly nature, thoughtful manner, and strong speaking skills are well regarded within the Eicher congregation. The key verse selected for the Eicher sesquicentennial celebration is Psalm 100, verse 5. For the Lord is good, and His love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations. We believe the history presented here tonight demonstrates this verse. This history records war and sorrows, new beginnings and celebrations, uneventful times and exciting periods. Through it all, the Lord is good, and His faithfulness does continue through all generations. We hold fast to this promise as the Eicher congregation looks with assurance to the future.